The Marshall Plan was a bold act of generosity and self-interest. The Americans who were sent over to run it believed their mission was straightforward: to make Western Europe strong and prosperous.
We Americans came to France with probably quite romantic ideas that we were going to bring this economic help and we would be welcomed with open arms and that economic development would happen and that the wounds of war would be bound up and so on. I don't mean to exaggerate it, but we all went there with a considerable amount of idealism. We were subjected to a number of jolts of reality. I remember that the first day I went to my office in the Hotel Talleyrand, I had to fight my way through a line of screaming pickets. They were members of the Communist Party in France who were picketing the building because of their claim that the Marshall Plan was simply an American scheme to control Europe and to control France.
What Europe still needed before everything else was food.
On reverra les pommes frites et le beefsteak. Et c'est même sûr qu'il y aura du beurre avec. Sans compter que pour l'amour, on en a déjà tous les jours. Et hop, on s'en sortira, on s'en tirera. Comme toujours en France, ça vient tout doucement, mais ça vient sûrement. Nous pouvons convoquer l'espérance. Et hop, on s'en sortira, tout remarchera. À brève échéance, il y aura du bonheur. Et le printemps reviendra. Et hop, on s'en sortira.
Food shipments were stepped up, but pride was at stake. People didn't like feeling dependent, and they suspected America's motives. The French left spoke disparagingly of coca colonization.
La civilisation de revolver. En France, on aime le bon vin. Et on sait l'apprécier. Coca-Cola. Allez, mon bonhomme, placez votre camelot ailleurs. En Amérique. En Amérique.
In Britain, an official film tried to calm similar anxiety in a more restrained style.
American aid? I can't say I've thought about it much, not really. But I do hope it doesn't mean a war with Russia.
Of course it doesn't. Though it should do a lot to stop communism spreading in Europe. Damn good thing.
I don't know with this American aid, not altogether. Too many tanks, if you see what I mean. You ought to read what Beaverbrook says.
You're all wrong, I tell you. I've lived in the States and I know. Why, you couldn't meet a nice lot of people. And generous, too.
Mummy! Do you think that American aid is a good thing?
I've no idea. You better ask your father. I've got far too much to do.
What Europe had to do was to grow more of its own food. So thousands of American tractors were sent across the Atlantic in the early days of the recovery program. Local officials were summoned to greet them, and their progress was proudly documented.
This time last year, in January 1949, there was something unique about the 70-acre farm of Albert Jolivet near Bourges. His old grandmother was full of a special pride, and so was his wife just a year ago. But proudest of all was Monsieur Jolivet himself. He was the first farmer in France to receive a tractor through the Marshall Plan.
Riding beside Monsieur Jolivet on the driver's seat was his 12-year-old son, Raymond.
They organized a demonstration along the main road. Lots of people stopped to see what was going on.
Pour se rendre compte du travail effectué par le tracteur.
They wanted to see what kind of work the tractor could do and to take a close look at it, since at the time we didn't see many in the countryside.
Dans la nature. Mais enfin, ça enlevait de la
what it did was to take some of the load off my father. We'd only used horses up till then.
Animal, hein. Mon travail était multiplié par 5 par
la, output increased fivefold par la, during busy periods like the harvest.
Pendant les périodes de travaux intenses comme la moisson.
Soon more fresh food appeared in the markets. Although everyday life got a little easier, a fundamental problem still had to be dealt with. European industry wasn't producing enough. Output was less than before the war. The machinery that had survived was worn out and inefficient. So Marshall Plan money went to re-equip the coal mines and to rebuild heavy industry. Entire steelworks were modernized. The Marshall Plan was to cost $13 billion.
Steel above all, steel to pound into 1,000 shapes, perhaps into cars and trucks like those now in production in Western Germany. For the Germans, so long committed to war production, today are turning their energy into peacetime channels.
Germany was now divided, and the Americans wanted West Germany to be a bastion of capitalism facing the communist East. In an outcome they'd never expected, the Germans took the third largest share of the aid. A prosperous Germany was thought essential to the rest of Western Europe's recovery. The biggest share of American aid went to Britain. The shipyards worked at full tilt to replace the ships that had been lost in the war. And though the mood of austerity continued, people were assured things were looking up.
The minister announced today that the British standard of living has improved during 1949, despite the dollar shortage and the general economic situation. The minister went on to say that this improvement is due primarily to the industry and initiative of the British people and to the generosity of American aid through the Marshall Plan.
In Italy, Giovanni De Stefanis was back at work.
E non solo a me, furono assegnate alcune macchine di provenienza statunitense.
In 1948, we were given some milling machines from the United States. They were from Cincinnati, Ohio.
Della Cincinnati, Ohio. E la loro provenienza era chiarissima.
It was obvious where they came from, because on the front there was a large badge divided in half. One half had the American flag, the other had the initials ERP.
L'altra metà era la sigla ERP. Che io immagino volesse dire.
I imagine this stood for European Reconstruction Plan. We knew that it was part of Marshall aid, and we all worked happily. This wasn't second-hand machinery, it was very efficient.
Macchinario effettivamente efficiente, ecco.
Altogether, 16 countries were helped in different ways. An enormous press sent from Chicago trundled through the French countryside.
Due, and the trip is over except for the final ride through town to the foundry. Plant workers turn out for a first look at the mechanical monster.
One of the workers watching at the roadside was Jean Dubertre.
C'était énorme.
It was enormous. I'll never forget, most of the workmen stopped what they were doing to come and see this brand new toy.
Here, the giant press from Chicago will be set to work stamping out parts for vitally needed French rolling stock. And a mighty machine will make a mighty contribution to France's economy.
À l'église, un beau petit homme demain qui sera
The mood in France began to change.
Obsédante et monotone,
Edith Piaf, France's most popular singer, set off with her entourage on a tour to the United States that was seen as a thank you to the Americans. And at home, French music hall audiences were reminded of who'd helped them in their hour of need.
Et maintenant, tu vas crier bien fort dans le micro, vive l'Amérique!
Vive l'Amérique!
Un, deux, trois!
Under the Marshall Plan, managers were brought over on visits to see the American way on its home ground. Jean Dubertre was in a party of French engineers.
Le but personnel d'un tel voyage,
the aim of the journey for me was to discover new methods of working in different atmospheres. Methods are one thing, they're a question of technique. But the way men relate to each other fascinated me.
Ça m'a toujours passionné.
Gonna take me a press, gonna take me some steel, gonna take my two hands and build an automobile.
Pour la productivité, je sais.
As far as productivity was concerned, I knew that we lost a lot of time doing useless things, and that we didn't really look into it too deeply.
Et on les étudiait pas, mais en Amérique, tout se mesure.
But in the States, they measured everything, even the handling which goes on in the workshop, the way parts move around. So it was interesting to see how the Americans went about analyzing the different elements, making up production costs, much more precisely than we did.
Put a brand new body on a brand new frame. Tighten her up and give it a name. Call it a dot.
And the French also saw how American workers lived.
We were struck by the fact that everyone could have a car, a house, and a garden.
D'avoir sa voiture, sa maison, son jardin.
They had everything, television, freezer, refrigerator, the lot. Our workers were astonished to find this was available to everybody.
The lessons were learned so rapidly that Europe began to be transformed in the 1950s. The most spectacular recovery came in Germany.
The first post-war Volkswagens were produced in a plant 60% destroyed by bombs. Less than 10 years later, an American-trained German expert had turned the company into one of the world's largest automobile manufacturing firms. New machines slashed the number of man-hours required to produce one car from 400 to 100. It's an industrial success story that seems miraculous.
George Steger worked as a cylinder grinder in Wolfsburg.
Ich erinnere mich noch ganz genau.
I remember when the millionth car left the production line. It was decorated with garlands and flowers. There was a large bouquet on the front. It looked beautiful, and we were so proud.
Also, es war ein Fest, dass ich
the party was unbelievable.
Habe, dass es sowas überhaupt gibt. Das ganze Volkswagenwerk hat mitgefeiert.
The whole factory celebrated. The whole town celebrated. Also, it was amazing.
Man konnte sich's nicht vorstellen. Die Leute haben auf den Straßen getanzt, gesungen.
People danced
haben
and sang.
Sich gefreut.
They were so happy
alles,
about what had
da
happened.
Uns geboten worden ist.
Those who celebrated at this rally were aware how much they owed to the Americans. But it was also a case of self-help, their own financial policy and good labor relations. And there was a new mood in Europe. The Europeans were now changing the political and economic map by themselves. A new era was launched with the Treaty of Rome in 1957.
Adenauer firma in vice del ministro degli esteri von Brentano.
Six countries signed, but not Britain, with the hope of ending old enmities and establishing a single market large enough to vie with the United States. And throughout Europe, governments were spending more on social programs.
Il y a 10 ans, à 15 kilomètres de Paris, ce tranquille village d'Île-de-France n'était peuplé que de retraités et de maraîchers. C'était vraiment la vie rustique à la campagne. Le vieux village n'a pas changé, mais une ville nouvelle de 45 000 habitants a surgi à proximité.
Massive public housing projects were started.
Le fait d'avoir eu ce logement, on était bien heureux.
We were tremendously happy to have this flat.
On a bu du champagne.
We had a big party and drank champagne. The first thing we did was to take a shower.
La première des choses, on a été se doucher.
You'll laugh, but the shower was the first thing that gave us pleasure.
Mais la douche, c'était la première des choses qui nous a fait plaisir. Dans l'autre maison,
in the other house, we didn't have a bathroom. It was sort of makeshift.
De dépannage, hein?
The same transformation was underway in every big city. New apartment blocks sprang up, along with hospitals and schools. Italian wages doubled, and a vehicle they'd invented themselves gave them a new freedom.
One inescapable symbol of recovery is the motor scooter. The Italian counterpart of the American worker's automobile. Nowhere in Italy are you ever out of reach of this ear-splitting post-war gadget.
Evio Beretti worked in the Vespa factory.
Le prime Vespe furono fatte.
The first Vespas were practically made by hand.
Quasi artigianalmente. Non c'era.
We didn't have the machines that we have today.
Che ci sono oggi, hai visto?
He was a happy man when he could finally afford his own machine.
Però nel 58, quando io avevo la Vespa, non è che tutti.
In 1958, when I bought my Vespa, it wasn't possible for a working man to afford a car.
Ne parliamo. La macchina del 58 per un operaio non esisteva. Ma la Vespa.
But with a Vespa, you could go to the mountains and pick mushrooms. I used to go with my wife to pick mushrooms. You could touch heaven with your fingers with your first Vespa and get around.
Volate! Oh! Cantare! Nel blu dipinto di blu, felice di stare lassù, e volavo, volavo.
All over northern Italy, brand new factories were increasingly productive. And even with labor-saving machinery, they couldn't find enough workers, so they took on more women. Edda Furlan had been a domestic servant.
Purtroppo, guardi, quando sono.
When I went there, they put me in the paint shop.
Assunta in smalteria. E allora puoi immaginarti, spruzzavano.
So you can imagine, we were spraying, and there was all the dust.
Fuori questa polvere. E allora, sai, dalla
testa. We had to wash from head to foot every day.
Ogni giorno dovevi lavarti. Però il lavoro.
That's the way it was. You just had to put up with it. There was no choice. It was poisonous work. It was very hot because once we'd cleaned them, they went into the furnaces at 600 degrees.
Commercial television helped glamorize products and feed the demand.
Fra tutte,
Una sola è la prima ballerina. Fra tutti, il frigorifero Naonis si distingue per lo stile inconfondibile. Naonis è differente.
Mia suocera ha detto,
my mother-in-law said, God bless the man who invented the washing machine. It's really something.
Sì, sono differenti e perfette anche le lavatrici Naonis.
D'inverno andavo anche
in the winter, I'd had to go and break the ice in the public washhouse to rinse the clothes.
E allora, sai, avendo provato e dopo aver la lavatrice, non so dirti cosa guadagno di tempo,
then, having a washing machine, I can't say what a saving that was. In time, health, everything.
Più di tutte qualsiasi altra cosa.
Finalmente posso dedicarmi di più alla famiglia.
Linea moderna, minimo ingombro.
The producers had become the consumers, just as in America.
Anche I tessuti più delicati. È proprio una meraviglia.
Not everyone moved so fast. The south of Italy had few jobs in 1960. So, like thousands of others, Gerardo Ciola had to leave.
We Italians are very attached to our families. It was painful to leave them, but we had to. We had to look for work somewhere else.
Però si era costretto per necessità ad andare.
At every station in southern Europe, they were saying goodbye.
Ogni anno centinaia di migliaia di italiani si spostano da sud a nord, inseguendo la speranza di un lavoro più sicuro e redditizio di quello offertogli dal loro paese natale.
Many of the migrants in Turin were helped by Father Giovanni.
Ricordi. Sono sempre.
Remembering those times is always a bit sad.
Che si vedevano questi treni.
One would see the trains coming in from the south and unloading these men.
Scaricare questi uomini con le loro valigie e soprattutto con.
They had all their baggage, and above all, their hearts were full of hope for a better life. They came to look for a job in order to get a wife, and then their greatest dream, a car.
Ultimo sogno, una macchina. Non avevano sogni irrealizzabili. Avevano semplicemente.
They weren't impossible dreams. People just wanted to achieve the standard of living they saw on television.
Che lo vedevano attraverso la televisione.
And Gerardo Ciola, after a while, could afford a small flat.
La prima cosa che ho voluto a casa.
The first thing I wanted in the house was a television. And then the other household goods.
Comprarmi la televisione e gli
every month there was something else to buy.
Bisogno, la lavatrice. Ogni mese doveva fare una spesa e cercare di fare una spesa.
The number of cars in Italy tripled in 5 years.
Nessuno, ti giuro, nessuno, nemmeno il destino ci può separare.
Tutti cominciavano a comprare la macchina e mi sono preso.
In the 60s, everyone started to buy cars, and I bought a Fiat 500. I went with my wife to Fiat.
E quando mi sono andato a consegnarmelo in Fiat, ho portato la moglie lì, mi sono messo dentro.
I felt so emotional that my legs were shaking. I was so excited.
Un po' emozionato che avevo qualcosa che potevo muovermi.
I'd worked and waited such a long time for this car.
Aspirata da tanto tempo che speravo di avere qualcosa della macchina.
Dire a una persona del popolo.
To tell a working man in Turin in the 1950s that in 8 years he'd own a car was like telling a man in 1500, one day I'll take you to the moon.
Guarda che ti porto sulla luna.
In 1959, a British election was fought on the slogan, You've never had it so good.
The country has never been so prosperous. As the Prime Minister has said, the standard of living has gone up. We are better fed, better clothed. We're using more electricity. More people have motor cars, bicycles, television, and a host of other things which only a few years ago were the luxuries of the few.
Coventry, planned as a people city in 1945, had been rebuilt. As one of the centres of the booming car industry, its workers were among the best paid in Britain.
It was the promise of better money which brought George Jordan to Coventry from the Newcastle pits. Now, at 59, with the souvenirs of a comfortable family life around him, Jordan, his wife and their two sons, Ray and George, have the kind of home which only good motor wages can provide.
The factories that were in Coventry at the time, car factories, as I say, there was about five factories. You could move to anyone you wanted. You know, if it didn't suit you at a job. I mean, I've known people that were there and weren't happy, didn't like their job and moved to another factory. Because the work was around, there was plenty of work.
After the war, all politicians had agreed it was the government's duty to see there were jobs for all. Full employment had become a reality. The Jordan's father had been unemployed in the 1930s, but his sons found work easily as soon as they left school. In 1960, unemployment in Britain was just 1%. And real wages went on rising.
I mean, you could go out for like £1.90, £7 or £8, and go for a meal, and you still have a few shillings left in your pocket.
There was money to be earned. Money to be earned and spent. So, and it's your idea. That's what I think money's for. Earn a pound, spend a pound.
Cheap credit made spending even easier. Television, carpets, cars were bought on the Never Never with plenty of time to pay. And people found new ways of spending their money in new places.
First time I went to Spain, I was 18. I think I took £50 with me. I couldn't spend it. You meet people on holiday, you know, and you talk. Oh, whereabouts are you from? Coventry. Oh, where all the big money's at? You know, it's a known thing.
In France, cities were deserted as workers took ever longer holidays. The new generation had put the austerity of their childhoods behind them. They'd grown up to become a group that had never been known before, teenage consumers. They spent with abandon. They followed American trends and bought American records. And France produced its own version of a rock and roll money spinner in Johnny Hallyday. On the surface, it might look as though Europeans were still in the thrall of America.
Qu'est-ce que Brigitte Bardot? Un élément non négligeable du commerce extérieur français. On lui est redevable, en partie, de l'équilibre approximatif de la balance import-export qui vient d'être enregistrée pour la première fois depuis de nombreuses années. Mais, bien sûr, le redressement sensationnel de l'exportation française a d'autres raisons.
But they had a new economic independence. Europe's own companies were thriving, and growth was helped by exports. They'd learned the American way so well that they now sent cars back across the Atlantic, competing with the Americans on their own terms. Americans discovered there were other ways to see the USA than in their Chevrolets.
Count the foreign cars in this picture. We'll even help you. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten.
In Germany, for 5 years, unemployment never rose above 1%, and there was a shortage of workers. George Steger felt like a rich man. Through our work, we gained self-respect, confidence. We felt we were somebody, we could buy things. That meant something, and we enjoyed it.
Man hat sich drüber gefreut.
We could dress up and show off like film stars. They'd always been dream figures to us.
Die an uns vorbeigeflossen sind. Wir sahen sie und waren aber doch so weit von denen entfernt.
We used to see them, but their lives seemed so far away. But not anymore. Now we become somebody.
Menschen.
In the space of a few years, Europeans who'd lived through such hardship after the war had become addicted consumers.
C'était comme un conte de fées parce qu'on voyait toutes ces choses.
It was like a fairy tale when we saw all these things, and as the prices got cheaper, we could buy them. And it wasn't a luxury to get a refrigerator.
Ça n'a plus été un luxe d'avoir un réfrigérateur. Après, ça a été une machine à laver, et puis plus tard,
then it was a washing machine. Then we had our own dishwasher. That was no longer a luxury. It wasn't an inaccessible dream.
Sans trop de problèmes, quoi. C'était pas un rêve inaccessible.
Alors, chérie, elle te plaît ta nouvelle cuisinière Radiola?
By the mid-1960s, Western Europe was closing the gap with America.
Quelle merveille!
Their incomes had doubled since the war.
Et cette machine à laver la vaisselle depuis le temps que tu la voulais.
Je t'adore.
Un magnétophone pour nous.
Ah, pour les enfants.
The lifestyle that had seemed so unattainable was finally within reach.
Un téléviseur en vision directe.
Ah, chic alors.
Un téléviseur portable.
Et un transistor.
Et la nouvelle machine à laver.
Sensationnel.
Un électrophone stéréo.
Oh.
Un électrophone à pile et un poste autoradio pour ta voiture.
Et tout ça, ces radios-là?
Oui, et aussi ce cassettophone.
Quel amour.
Heureuse.
Comblée. Radiola. Après la guerre en France,
after the war in France, we had what we call the 30 glorious years. Life was easy.
La vie était facile.
Jobs weren't a problem. And it seemed that all our dreams had come true.
Il semblait que tous nos rêves pouvaient être réalisés.
But one of the main assumptions underlying the long boom was about to change. Ever since the war, both America and Europe had relied on cheap oil. It had helped to pay for the mass consumption and full employment. Suddenly they saw how dependent and vulnerable they'd become.
Depuis longtemps, on l'appelait l'or noir. Et nous savions tous qu'il n'était pas seulement le nerf de la guerre, mais aussi le sang du monde moderne. Il a suffi d'une menace de disparition pour que le pétrole devienne Dieu.
The shock came in 1973, when the Arab oil producers quadrupled their prices. It marked a turning point and an end to the heady confidence. For 20 years, they'd lived with little care for tomorrow. But now the days of cheap petrol and the certainty that the West dominated the world was over. It was the beginning of the end of the greatest boom of the century.
When I think of all the good times that I've wasted having good times, when I think of all the good time that's been wasted having good times, when I was drinking I should have been thinking, when I was fighting I could have done the right thing. All of that boozing I was really losing. Good times. Good times.